All right, let's continue our study of the book of Esther. We are broadcasting on three. We are recording and we are broadcasting on Ustream, and also on Periscope, Twitter. I will encourage you to download Twitter app into your cell phones or iPad or tablet, and also download Periscope. Periscope goes with it so that you can watch. I'll be able to broadcast to you wherever I am very easily. Are there some people who are on Periscope tonight? All right. I hope you all have your Bible for us to continue. And all right, who are those with their Bibles tonight? Are there people with their Bibles tonight?
Yes, Bishop, I mean, I have my Bible with me.
There we go. That's interesting. I'm very pleased to hear that. Let's see where we stopped. Let's see.
I have my Bible.
All right, that's good. Ladri, do you have your Bible with you? All right, we've read.
I have one, yeah.
Okay.
I have one.
Very good. William, how are you?
All right.
Okay. Let's begin. All right. Let's see. All right, we have done verse number 17. So, let's go to verse number 18 of Esther chapter 2. Let's begin from there. Leonard, do you have your Bible tonight? Okay, she's not there. Let's begin with Berlin, please.
And servant, and he proclaimed a holiday in the province and gave gifts according to the generosity of the king.
Okay, look at that. Look at that. Then the king made a feast. He made a great feast unto all his princes and his servants, even Esther's feasts. Let's pick out what we must pick out from here. When you achieve something that is of great value, when you achieve something that is of great value, let me see how this goes. Always spend time to celebrate anything that you have spent time and money. If you have invested money, time, and talent into anything, You must celebrate it. I am aware of people who, after obtaining a certificate in one specific area of training, they lose interest in it. Absolutely, I've seen it. They lose interest in it. They don't really pay much attention to it anymore. Same thing. There are a lot of people who are crying, they want a husband, they want a husband. When they find one, and God say yes to it, they lose interest in it. Natalie should have been on this conference too. There were things that she brought out that I did not want us to continue without us touching on that. So let's look at it. You see, at the beginning of the reading of the book of Esther, we faced a king who asked for a queen to come and show off her beauty and intelligence, addressed the kingdom, sit by his side. People of God, I want to tell you something. In ancient times, the husband has his room, an office, and the wife has hers. In fact, if you began to look at the lives of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, all those people, that was the tradition. They understood something that you need to know. There are certain visitations of God that requires you alone to be with him. They understood the place where an individual need to spend time in detail to think over things, plan. So they had that custom. Nowadays, if you have such a thing, your wife or husband will accuse you that it's because there's something you are doing in secret. That's why you do not want them to stay in one place. But I also have come to notice something. If you and your wife have the same dream, you are pursuing the same dream, you are connected with the same dream, tied down to the same destiny, then why not stay in one wonderful, huge bedroom? I mean, I know that sometimes people have so much clothes and personal things that they need their space. They need their own wardrobe. Like for me, I'll always need my space for prayer, for studies, and some days to stay there with God. This was the practice of ancient royalty. For the king, because in those days, kings had concubines. The nobles did. So even if you were their wife, if you were the queen, you only come to the king when the king needed you. Or the king come to you, but always you go to the king. That was how, or you go to the queen, depending on who was ruling. Now, there is a question here. Somebody brought something to my attention today. Natalie brought that to my attention. She brought something when we were dealing. She watched the video of when we were speaking about why do some women despise their husband. So I said, before we celebrate the Feast of Esther, before we talk about why feasts are necessary, men and women chosen for honor understand the power of throwing a party, a real party. Party for politics, party for power, party for money. Not just party for you to invite anyone to come and eat up your food and drink. It is for you to do business, for you to select people, for you to watch people and know who fits in. It is also to celebrate a great achievement. So there was a feast for Esther herself. The king made a feast for Esther. And I believe Esther threw a feast to honor people like Haggai, her uncle, Mordecai, family members. Invited the king and his families. Those seven maidens that helped her. So she threw parties for the women of the harem. Why did Esther do that? For power, to consolidate her power, but with meekness. I have seen people who come from very poor and wretched family, when once they gain position of power, they become very arrogant, they become saucy, defiant, very stubborn. I've also seen people who come from wealthy families and they are very quiet, they are very meek. Power doesn't run wild on them for them to begin to disturb people with it. Na 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 na. There we go. Let me ask this question tonight, since Natalie is still on the road. You guys know that she owns a taxi cab company that I prophesied into her life and it came about. So she herself, sometimes she drives. Others do drive for her. So she's not here to address that issue. That's why I'm bringing it. Ladry and Bernice, Deborah, William, all of you tonight, I need an honest answer. Do you guys think that the queen that was overthrown did not want to come and show her beauty and to come and show her wisdom, address the kingdom of King Ahasuerus of Persian Media? Do you guys think that she despised the king because she was a trophy wife? Please, let's talk about trophy wife. Who is a trophy wife? Chantel, are you with me tonight? I need an answer from you. Wherever you are in the world, if you're on Ustream, you can mute Ustream and contribute and come to the phone line. I need an answer tonight. Who is a trophy wife?
Trophy wife is the wife that prays for her husband and dresses herself well, head up, shoulder back, and support her husband.
Okay, whose voice is that so that I can know Ada to talk, Ada to how to address you? Who is this?
Actually, this is Noet.
Noet, you've been sneaking into the conference. After your marriage, you went and secretly married. You did not invite me to your marriage. I have prayed for you. I've prayed for you, and I love your two beautiful daughters on that picture.
Thank you.
You look very, very gorgeous. I didn't know that was going to happen so quick. So what did you say? You are, Your background is Vietnamese, is that right?
Yes.
Okay, I remember. See, how I remember people and their background is something that is beyond me. You can tell me something about you once, it's just like, bam, click, it doesn't leave me anymore, even after so many years. Who is a trophy wife? Explain something to me, please.
A trophy wife is a wife that takes good care of herself, looks nice, and also proud to have a husband that she supports him no matter what. That's how I
think. Okay, that's a trophy wife. Okay, who again has another answer? Who is a trophy wife? Please, you guys know this. Speak up. Speak up. Who is a trophy wife? Okay.
I think that the trophy wife, according to me, is someone that always stands, you know, for her husband, and that is always there for him. No matter what situation, you know, what is going on, she always stands with him and will present him wherever she goes. Or wherever she connected or surrounding with.
Okay. What's the word? Thank you, Berlin. What does the word trophy means? Geneva, you know an answer to this, and Victoria and the rest of you. I need to hear your voice tonight. Who is a trophy wife, according to how we look at it? See, if you did not speak, if you did not speak tonight, I will be in Montreal tomorrow morning. You know that.
I was a trophy wife.
Okay.
So I was like the beautiful woman who was standing by my man, not saying anything, just be with him, and just be beautiful, and that's it. I was not allowed to talk and not allowed to say anything. I was just like my pride, just a trophy. Like he was like proud and very happy for him to be dressed well. Exactly.
So the thing is this: there was a contest for you. Others saw your beauty and he quickly ran, and he was the one that shot the game, the big prize. He got the big prize.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that was the trophy he won in the game.
Yeah.
Okay. He married you for your beauty. Basically, because of your beauty.
Exactly.
Okay, so he didn't need your brain, your mind, your creativity.
No.
What he didn't care about what you are capable of doing, your dream. No. So you were just there to entertain him, and you sometimes you are not allowed to know what he's doing, even how he earns his money. You're not allowed to know. Okay, you don't know who are all these friends around him. You have no idea.
No.
Okay. Most of where he keep his money, you don't know. People come in and out of the house. Sometimes you are not allowed to ask questions what is really going on.
Exactly. Okay. I don't know anything.
Okay, so many a times he leaves the house, he travels, and he tells you where he's going. He may call you. He may not call you. He may go out on the weekend with his male friend. You have no idea what they are doing there, but you are not allowed to ask questions. Is that right?
It's right. Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so if you begin to voice your opinion, there is war, there is unhappiness, and it will be like you are betraying him. So it's basically a slave, a master-slave mentality.
Exactly, yeah. I was a princess in a gold castle, and
I didn't allow to say anything, just be there and be his trophy wife. That's it.
Okay. So, in essence, also, he uses you whenever he wants to satisfy his appetite. He calls you into it, and that is all it is. And then if he is going out to somewhere where wife, they should bring their wives, he makes sure you have the best dress, you look your best, and he parades you. But deep inside you, you know that you are just wearing the ring, but you are nothing more than the ring. Is that right?
Exactly. Yeah, it's right. And he never said to me I was beautiful or anything like that. No,
do you guys see why I adopted her and I became what I am with this girl? And trophy wives can be betrayed and thrown out and divorced at any time. You guys know this.
Yes, my first husband was that one.
Okay. Is there somebody that wants to contribute more to this trophy wife of a thing? Are you guys aware that this is going on in the world and many women feel that that is what love is about? Ladri, jump into this because you know a lot. I know that you don't talk much. You know, jump into this. Are you guys aware that a lot of women feel very happy that they are like that? That they think it is honor. You are never consulted about his business. You are never told to be involved in it. You are just to minister to him, and that is all it is. For some men, they are good. They provide you with everything you need. They provide you with everything that you need. But they basically do not need you in the running of the affair of their home or their business or their dream. And many a time when such men dies or they depart this earth, you don't really know much. You begin to sit back and ask yourself, do I really know who this man is? And people begin to tell you things about his days, his business, his money, his that. And you are like, really?
Yeah.
And then sometimes the debt collectors begin to pile up. And you are like, I don't know anything about this. Do you guys think, is there somebody who want to add something to this?
So my ex-husband, this is Noah, he had handled money and everything, treated me like I was, don't have to worry about everything, but he was hiding everything. So I didn't have anything to say. Because I was a little wife, and I was just be there, just like your lady there that said that, the way her husband treated her.
Yeah.
That's how mine was, too. Just be quiet, and she handled everything.
Okay.
And now I'm with the...
How you know that you are a trophy wife is that you are not allowed into the business. And number two, you are not allowed to handle anything. But some women take that to mean that the man really loves them. He never asks you, what is your dreams? What do you want to achieve in life?
No.
How do I help you build your dream? It's just all he wants is, come and be my queen.
Yes, and it's all about him.
Yes, it's all about him.
Yeah.
Remember that song by Billy Ocean? Caribbean Queen. Boom, 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 boom. Remember those kind. You see, you are just a queen.
Yeah.
But you are not allowed to exercise being a queen. So you are a ceremonial queen. You have ceremonial power. You cannot exercise it. Why? Because all the power is consolidated in the king. Do you guys think that that was what happened to Vashti? Is that why she despised the king? Or was it because of so many other factors? Now, let me ask this question. How do trophy wives react when they begin to become adults in their mind? When they begin to think of what they should become, how do trophy wives think? What normally happens when they begin to think of their freedom? Do you think being a trophy wife is slavery?
Yeah.
Is it not supposed to be enjoyment? Berlin, come in here. Ladri, help me. Geneva, help me. Help me. I need help from these women. I need help from men.
Bishop, I don't think that, to my opinion, I don't think that it's a slave. It's all depend of the concept, and also it all depend on what has been established from the beginning. So if, if from the beginning there were some rules or some of the things that she wasn't allowed to do, regarding, the king or whatever the king was doing, I think that she has to obey and just follow the rules and whatever principle was established. So I don't see that as, as a slavery. It's just she has to honor that because it's a, it has been established, and then she has to honor what her husband does.
Okay.
So I don't see that as a slavery.
Okay.
I think that there was something maybe, under that, and that something under that shouldn't be exposed in public or before the eyes of, whoever was on, the king, in the kingdom, like she's supposed to deal with it.
Okay.
With her husband in a very appropriate and, private way.
Okay. Nice.
Yeah,
So you are saying that she should know what she was walking into.
Exactly.
Okay. There are also something that we need to know tonight. Marriage is not for kids. In some cultures, they will give away anybody for marriage, any girl for marriage, especially the girls. And that is totally wrong. When a girl is not mentally developed, socio-psychologically developed, why should she get into a marriage? Because at that stage, she could become, without knowing it, a trophy. Everybody is giving him compliment for such a young wife, beautiful. But I wonder how much compliment he himself will give that woman when she starts bearing kids, the belly start stretching. Yeah, stretch marks begin to appear. The butt began to shed. Little wrinkles here and there. She began to walk funny because of all the stretches from the kids shooting in and out of her. And all the signs on the wall of stress that she cannot even avoid. She's not, her opinion is not needed anywhere in many things. So if she was a trophy wife in her 20s when she was married, by the time she reached 30, 35, she began to think. She began to...
And that's when they want to leave or they rebel.
Okay, repeat that.
Rebellious, or they want out.
That's when they want out?
Yeah, some of them.
Yeah.
If they're independent.
Okay. So that's, I always see it like when one they reach 30, they are still emotionally attached. When one they begin to reach 35, 40, they are done. They begin to see the world the way it is. Do you know what it means to be a mom? To be a mom is one of the most wonderful, whether you adopt kids or whether you're a mom to somebody that is not even your kid. So mom is not just for people who have children. Or whether you're a mom, which means you have many kids of your own or adopted ones. So I want you to be aware that it takes two. Just doing laundry alone, vacuuming, cooking, cleaning the kids, taking them out to play, watching over them, going grocery shopping. That's a full-time job. And then for some of you who in the midst of that have a full-time professional employment, my goodness. And the stress and the trauma of those things is not a small thing. And then after the laundry, ironing, taking them to school, you'll be called from your job to the school, from this to the that. It's not a small thing. It's
A lot of minority women, a huge number, don't even have husbands, just single mothers.
a lot of what minority women?
Yes,
Okay,
don't even have husbands.
explain who are minority and who are majority.
Well, with the minority, well, we have a lot of different minorities in the country now, but I'm thinking about the black. A lot of black women don't have husbands.
Why is it that they don't have husbands? There are many reasons why they don't have husbands, because there are so many. I've also.
That's a whole nother. That's a whole nother. That would take a long time to go into all the social things that happen. But anyway, when I was
Well,
growing up, restricted was
I
like
will
two
argue, I will
and a half.
argue very strongly that how I was born, where I was born, how I've been treated by anybody since I was born is not going. I will never define my future and my today. I refuse it.
No, I'm not defined. I'm just saying they don't have. It's the fact they don't have. And it's a lot of stuff that happens. It's different from when I was growing up. 9 out of 10 had husbands. Now it's the other way around. That's a whole other conversation. But I'm just saying it's really hard, for single mothers.
Okay. Geneva. I don't think Ladri is with us tonight. I'm not sure. Ladri, are you in the conference tonight? Okay. You and Berlin and Geneva should remind me to do a conference whereby we are going to discuss why there are so many single mothers. What are the reasons? I want us to address that very quickly. We need to. Why are there so many single mothers? And many of them refuse to be with men sexually. They decide they have ended, they shut everything down. It's not that they are single women and they still have men friends. They just shut it down. They invite the guy married to come with padlock and chains and chain everything up and go with the key. Seriously, they don't want to have anything to do with men. And I've seen many of them, they work hard and take care of their kids. They don't care about whatever, about men. They are not interested. So we need to do a conference. Why are many women? I've seen a lot of Caucasian women, European women, they are single. Many, 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 too many.
Oh yeah, there are a lot, but the statistics is higher in the. I just see,
In the black community?
Yeah, there's some, but not as many as in the black race.
Well, we are going to look at the research. We are going to research that and see what the statistic says about the single moms and so on and so forth. All right. And also remember the mentality of poverty. Remember, now it's going to dawn on each and every one of us. Why I say that? Two poor people should never get married. Two poor people should never make babies. Now it's dawning on you. You now know it. If you come from a poor background, you don't need to get with somebody who is of a poor background like you. You must see somebody who has a future and can take you to that future, and you are able to take that person to that future. It's not two people who are on food stamp and they are trying to make a family. You're joking. You are joking. Seriously, you're joking. It's not gonna work. Let's face, this is not about prayer. In fact, anybody who goes to pray for such joining will be counted as a transgression against him or her, because you know that that wasn't a good joining, and you tried to join it. You are bringing two people to come and kill each other, betray each other, destroy each other. If one of them tried to move forward, the other one is saying, really? Are we not supposed to go together in poverty, and now you want to leave me into prosperity? Envy and jealousy.
They have money, don't want to spend it.
You say what?
Sometimes they have money and don't want to spend it.
There you go. There you go.
So they can be successful, have money, but still not want to spend it or spend it in the right places. Be responsible.
Let's listen to what Berlin said. Berlin said something very important. That it was not just that Vashti despised her husband, but that any woman going into marriage should go there as an adult. Berlin, is that what you mean? They should know clearly what they are entering into. So that tomorrow they do not say they did not know. Let me tell you Let me share with you the ideology or the slogan of pimps. I'm talking of professional pimps, men or women. Women who pimp other women into prostitution, or men who pimp women into prostitution, or women who pimp men into prostitution, or men who pimp other men into prostitution. So listen to this. They have one slogan. Pimping, allowing another person to pimp you, is a choice that you must decide to make. Even when you are forced into it, you have the right to flee. You have the right to stop a cop and say, I am under this kind of thing. But the pimp, sometimes as matter, they put you on drugs. Because there is one, and in fact, all pimps that I know do not use their real name. They all use fancy name. Like Big Town, you know? Yeah. Big Tires. They have fancy names. You never know who that is until you are. It's coded. It's a coded game. And sometimes he treats them nicely, outwardly, or sometimes inwardly in the house. But sometimes they treat them, it appears like they are being treated nicely outside, but inside they are being beat up, chained up, raped, all kind of stuff. I want you to be aware of this. You must not just think that because something is nice, this man is nice to you, kind to you, all of that, that is all good. Well, it's all good. You don't need to really worry about it. That's not true. You need to know what you are entering into, who that person is. The reason why you need to know, The reason why you need to know is so that it's a choice you are making. Sometimes parents know that a girl is not able to make that choice. And they push you to go in there so that they'll be getting money from the man. Chantel, is that true?
Understand what Berlin is saying, but sometimes you get through a marriage and you know, you're like, it's the way you've been raised, like the way I was raised. My mom was alone, a single mother, and she was always telling me that I should depend on a man and he's supposed to take care of me, and when he has money, that's the best thing for me to have, and it should be okay because he's taking care of me. So I was not, like, I was young, I was not aware of myself, and you know, sometimes you get through it and you're just trying to believe that it's a good thing, and after that you realize that it's not. But at the first time you like, you're trying to be the best and to try to make this marriage work, but it's not always like, how can I say that? It's not always like a choice that you have to be aware, because sometimes the way you've been raised, you know, sometimes you make poor choices, but I don't know if you understand what I'm trying to say.
Yes, I'm following you. Yes, I'm following you. I understand. So, a single mom, a little bit or more of a dysfunctional family, you have been coached by a mom, or coached by a dad, depending on who, that if you want to get anything, it's going to be through a man.
Exactly.
Okay. It's going to be through a man. So, what happened here is, you have that mentality ingrained in you.
Exactly.
That all you just need to do is be submissive.
Mm-hmm.
And then you can get all you want in life from that man.
Yes.
So it's like, know how to play your game and you can have all you want, but it will always be through a man. I am making sense of what you're saying, because I have seen women who, I don't need no man. All of them, they are all dogs. They are this. I don't need them. And then the next minute, she's kissing a man by the streets, and they are speeding away with her. So I'm like, this doesn't make no sense. She doesn't want no man. But she depend on them. So it doesn't rhyme. But I still believe. So we have to see how we can balance these two things.
There's another group in this country too. Thousands of us would talk. You know, even we were from two parent households, but we were taught to. Because of what was happening around in the 60s and 70s, the opportunities opened up that most of the women didn't have, because 50 to 60% of the women used to be housewives. But when the opportunities opened up that we could go to college, they taught us, you know, to concentrate more on having a career and being independent and not having to depend on a man. So there were thousands who never... you know, they never got married or they let that go to get their education. So that's the problem. That's the issue we have.
But also, in a real sense, that is why if you don't plan, then you plan to fail. I have seen women who are in marriages, wonderful marriages, and they still pursue their goal. They had their PhDs, they become medical doctors and so on. So
yeah,
yeah, I have seen that, and I thought that is pretty good. But
yeah, some of them did, but some of but that wasn't their goal. It's like your main thing was, for example, when I was 18, I had an opportunity. I could have got married, or I could have gone in the Air Force, or I could have gone to college. And I chose to go to college because sometimes the men mess up and you'll still have your career.
There you go.
Now I look back, I believe that I might have been better off if I would have got married, because I would have been in a better shape.
Okay.
According to, you know, but, you know, that wasn't your main goal. Yeah, some of them did get married, but they put that was number two. You did that second. You got your career first.
Okay. I got it.
Mm-hmm.
I think
I would have been better if I would have got married and then went to school after I was married.
Okay.
And sometimes, Unika, it's the example that you have. Like, I saw my mom, like she was raising us and alone and also depending on the men. So for me, it was normal. You know, it depends. So it depends the way you've been raised from a parent. That's the way you make your choices after when you grow up.
I see.
Yeah.
I can now understand why for some women, the husband that she's married to, the parent of that girl know that man is a pimp, or that man is a drug dealer. But because the money is coming in, it's all about the money and the material resources. And I can assure this, a lot of women who knows that their husbands are into heavy drug, they are heavy drug dealers. The money comes from there. They can cover it up with some little jobs they do here and there, but the real money is coming from something bigger than that. And I can see why they protect, or they are pimps. And I can see why their wives do protect them. They hardly talk. They won't say anything. Because they understand clearly what they are doing. Now, so there are many reasons that we can give for our wife despising her husband when she comes of age, or when she realizes that there are more things about her than just being a trophy wife, somebody to be shown and paraded, never consulted, dream never developed, and I think there's so much, and that could make a woman to despise her husband.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Is there somebody that want to add more to this?
I was thinking that maybe that she started hitting him a little bit, you know, inside, because he didn't, wasn't the way she wanted him to be with her. And then, you know how it says, he was drinking before he called her out. Or maybe she wanted just to show off in front of the other women, because just I'm not going to go over there, you know, and didn't realize that what he was going to do to her. She was probably shocked and surprised when she found out that she couldn't be the queen anymore.
Okay, Bishop, can I say something also?
Yes.
Yeah, I think that what she's saying is not true. I think that's the way Vati maybe feel. She felt like maybe she was going to show up a little bit, because I don't think that, you know, she wasn't aware of what she was going to face during, you know, her life with the king in the kingdom, if I can put it that way. So I think that she was trying to be a little bit arrogant, and she did it in a very wrong way.
Okay.
Without realizing that, you know, it will affect, you know, the honor of her husband. So that's why, you know, many women that get married earlier, including me, I was married earlier before. You know, you tend to do things without thinking. And also, I think that today God is calling all of us, all of us. You know, if we chose to get married again, if we chose to build up a new life, we have to think twice. We have to really know that the marriage is not something to be playing with. It's a very big responsibility. It's a commitment. It's a covenant. And whenever you committed to a man, and whenever you sign that covenant, it's not only with that man that you committed to, it's before the eyes of God.
Yeah.
You know, you committed before him, and you have to really, really honor that. So what happened is that whatever happened in the relationship, whatever problem you guys facing, because no one is perfect, you have to find a way to really handle it, and not to handle it, you know, in a sense that it's going to destroy one another or destroy whatever you guys trying to build. So you have to really be careful and know that there is a goal to achieve, there is a covenant that has been made, and it must be, you know, honored and, you know, and fulfilled. Basically, that's the way I see it.
Okay.
You, Bishop.
Yes, this is Mary. I mean, what you just said is right in the sense that it is just exactly what made our mothers to persevere in marriage.
Okay.
Many women back home where I came from, Nigeria, no matter, I know they went through a lot, but they persevered, they still remained, you know, by the side of their
husbands.
And so that's exactly what we ourselves are looking on to. I might say my mom lived with my father, you know, despite any ill treatment maybe she might be she faced. And so the same way I might say, let me just stay with that man and continue to believe the Lord. But to an extent, I mean, if a man comes up with a lot of, it's like abuse. You as a woman, you won't say, I will continue in that situation because I still want to persevere the way my mom did.
Right.
It's a very, I mean, so we have to look into it and ask God to direct and guide us.
Well, the best thing. Yes, Mary, thank you very much. The best way to solve these marriage problems so that you don't become a trophy wife. You are to be seen, you are not to be heard. And even if you do, your contribution is not seen. I want you to be aware of something. That's why God gave me some big ideas about marriage for me to teach the world. There are three things and two additional things and seven additional things that I will be writing about and be talking about more about marriage. If you don't have the basic three, the basic two, you are not qualified for a relationship or friendship. The basic three, the number three, the foundational three, you are not even ready to pass the test for a marriage. Many people want somewhere to settle, a roof over their head, a place where they can exercise power. This is how Natalie put it. She said this. It was not just that Vashti despised her husband. It was this. That when a woman receives a ring, is a sign of great power. A woman considers signing that marriage certificate, that license that says you are Mrs. This, and then that ring, that those two things is power in itself. And if a woman doesn't know how to handle the ring and that signature, and then if she's given opportunity to be in charge of money and have power over people, for example, your husband will open a big shop for you, you are in charge of the money, doesn't ask you. Or he give you the paycheck, you run the affair. It's a tendency for some women to abuse that because they are not used to how to handle power and money, that they abuse it. Power is one of the reasons why many women now say, I now have the man. I wear his ring. I signed the contract. He is now mine. I can now do whatever I want to do. That's another side of looking at it. And there are women who actually come to a marriage to exercise power that they've never had. Because now they have a man who has money. And they can now begin to exercise such power. That's why women like that will find it difficult to be in Muslim marriages, where the man will bring more wives. And of course, from the territory that I'm from, Mary, you know this, that ancient practice, some of the cultures is still there. A man goes on a journey, and another family find him worthy, and they give him the gift of their daughter. Mary, you know what I'm saying? They give him the gift of a woman, because they want their daughters to also come. They say, look, this man is like a big loaf of bread. Why should you, this woman in the house, be the only one eating the bread? This bread is too big for you alone. Let our daughter also come in and also share in this. How dare you? If you don't want it, they use witchcraft. Either they use it and kill you and send you out so that their daughter stay, or you shut your mouth and let their daughter come in too and become a co-wife. 2 days, the man established a big grocery store for the second wife to run, to manage. Seriously. And they do that to keep the power of the first wife in check. That's how they do it. Remember what that Muslim taxi driver told me from Somalia. He said to me, his mother used to abuse his father. Sometimes his father will come back from his job, the mother has not cooked anything. She's cooked for her children, has nothing put for him. And so his father was crying one day. The mother was just so powerful a woman. She was controlling everything. So the father's uncle came and said, why are you crying? He said, he has not eaten. Now he has to go to a hotel to go and look for food. They said, oh, don't worry, we know how to handle it. And they left that night, went to went among their family members, and they brought a new woman into their house against the will of this woman. They told her, if you want to stay, you're going to live with her. She's the new wife. It's legal. It has been signed and sealed. Her dowry has been paid. And they found it. They gave her a room of her own. The new wife came immediately. Scented her bed, her new bed. I mean, you'll be entering into that house. You can smell the incense oil in her bedroom. And the man was not going to the old wife anymore. He was going to the new one. Before he come back from his job, the new wife has kept water, made his bad water, cooked for him, was frying fish and meat, all kind of things. This man was in heaven. And when the old wife now saw what was happening, that there is now power playing the house, she now also began to cook for him, and the man didn't want to eat his food anymore. He said, this man told me that the reason why Muslims marry many women is so that when one woman bluff you, you have other women to take care of you. You have another wife to take care of you. If one is on her menses, he goes to the one who is not on menses. If one is pregnant, he goes to the one who is not pregnant. So that nobody put that man under his pocket. That's why they married in order to make those women buck against themselves and compete for that man's love. He said that's what they do, and that is what women deserve. I said, you must be out of your mind. And he just married last year, October. The wife gave birth, I think a month ago. The last time that I was in a taxi, he said to me that he's going to go and marry another woman and bring in. Seriously. That he doesn't want to be hungry in his own house. That this one will be busy with the child, and he will drive a taxi all day and come home to come and cook for himself or so. Maybe by that time they are sleeping, that the second wife will be waiting for him with food and everything. Say, really? That's how they think.
I hope not in our country.
Yeah, but that's how Muslims behave. And you, the wife, you can't say anything. In fact, in some Muslim country, the man is given the authority. If that woman questions his authority, to take the woman to the outside and invite the neighbor to come and watch and cut her head off. And her people will say nothing. I'm serious. Very barbaric way of life. It's very uncivilized. I mean, you've not been able to solve the problem of one woman, you are going to get another one in. Do you know what it means for two different human beings to stay together as husband and wife, and you are going to bring two more women? Or like in some place in Kenya, a woman can marry more than one, or the native Indians of the Amazon jungle, a woman can marry more than one man. Yes. In Kenya, the Maasai still practice it. In other cultures, the woman can marry more than one man. If you are coming in to be with her and you see a spear on the door, Christine is not on the line. She knows this. If you are coming to come and visit her, you see a shoe or a spear on the door, you go back. You know that your colleague, your co-husband is there. So you go. Oh, yeah. That's how they do it. That's terrible stuff. That's terrible stuff. Very terrible. Yeah. So these are some of the things that I want you to be aware of. Be careful about the ring. And be careful about saying because you are the wife, because sometimes it reaches that point where the man decides to just treat you as a trophy wife. And that's why some women says, okay, some women outside with the husband as a concubine they, or mistress, some women will go, okay, you are marrying the ring, but I'm marrying the man. Some do that. A lot of corruption in government and people in government is because most of all these officials are keeping so many mistresses, buying them houses, cars, and all of that. I don't understand this. But you see, the most interesting thing about Esther is that she knew the art of negotiation. She had the gift of understanding. She knew exactly what she was walking into. Why? She had two people and seven maidens who were guiding her. She had her uncle, Mordecai. She had Haggai, the chief eunuch. She had seven maidens who taught him what the kingdom requires. So you see, what Berlin say must be taken very seriously. You must know what you are walking into. The reason why women walk into what they do not know is that they don't ask questions. They just go with the flow. They go with the flow.
That was me.
Yeah, they go with the flow. They go with emotional energy, and they are very naive. They think they know it all. And the man is very calculating and knows exactly what he's doing.
Some of them are liars and good actors, too.
You mean the men?
Oh, yes.
Both sides, too. The women, too. The women, too, could be liars and manipulators, too. They know how to manipulate him until the witchcraft put on him will not work anymore, and then he starts manipulating them. And if it is even worse, it is worse if the woman went and did her witchcraft and the man went and did his witchcraft, so two cobras against each other. And it will be, I can see you and I know you can see me.
What happens when someone puts witchcraft on someone to get to marry them, and if they later on get saved, are they still supposed to be faithful in that marriage?
Okay, ask the question again.
Good question.
Ask that question again. Somebody should answer that question. Women, please help me. Somebody should help us, because you ask yourself, who put that marriage together in the first place?
Mm-hmm.
That's the question here. So that kind of ministries, whoever is in charge of that ministry, you should bring the person to me. Let me put a whooping rod on his back. Let me tell you, getting saved does not make people who are bent on doing something. Let me tell you what woman told me. One woman told me that church is a trend, church is a fad. That's where you go to get some of the best. So you go to those things, do those things, and come to church. A lot of churches, there is no power. There is no power of the Holy Ghost to expose things. You know, if the pastor is practicing witchcraft, what do you think the others are not practicing? So think about that. So getting saved does not move me. People get saved, they are still possessed by demons. They are still doing all manners of wickedness, all kind of stuff. They are stealing. They are manipulating. They are lying. They are greedy. And they are born again. So that doesn't move me. That does not move me.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people use being born again and they cover up a lot of things that you have no idea until it is brought out in the open. That's why I'll create a lot of problems for a lot of people in conferences and so on.
Mm-hmm.
Because I'll just be exposing things left, right, and center. But I'll ask God for wisdom before I do anything. Because there's a place where you know so much and God tell you don't say anything because there'll be too much disaster here. Now, if someone, they put witchcraft on you and then you got born again, deliverance is needed for that person. Because the person was under bondage. Okay, how is it that a man woke up from his sleep and saw his beautiful wife by his side and woke her up and said, "Who are you?" And the wife said, "You must be joking. You asking who I am?" Yeah, the man said, "I'm serious. Who are you?" Say, "You are waking me in the middle of the night. Did you smoke something or did you drink something? What's wrong with you?" Said, "No, no, no, I'm serious. How did you get into this bed?" The woman said, "Yeah, how did you get into this bed? I'm going to call the cops on you." She said, "You are out of your mind. We are married." And the man said, "When were we married? When did that happen?" The lady said, we had the biggest wedding in this city. Everybody came. We have two grown-up kids." And the man said, "I have no idea what you're talking about." Then the woman said, "Okay, I'm going to call the cops. We need to get you committed because something is wrong with your mind or with your brain. We need to get you to the neuropsychiatric ward." He said, "No, no, no, you don't get me into any neuropsychiatric ward. I'm asking you right here, right now, how did you climb? How did you break through my door?" He went out to go and touch his door. "How did you? Did you come through the window of the roof? How did you end up here, woman?" The woman went, called the parent for them to come, called the cops and said, "The husband is crazy." The husband said, "Listen, I'm not crazy. Everything is fine. I work in so-and-so place. But I'm so shocked that I'm waking up this morning and I'm seeing this woman in my bed. I want to know how did..." They said to her, "Now, you see those pictures on the wall in the living room? Is that you? On your wedding day, do you know how long you've been married to this woman?" He said, "How long?" They told him. He said, I'm finished. They said, "Why are you saying you are finished? What is going on here?" You know, the cops do not understand supernatural things. They are like, "My God, this man has a mental issue. We should take this man. This man should go to the hospital to get his head examined and scanned. There's something wrong here." The man said, "Don't get me to anywhere. I know what I'm talking about. Is that me in that picture?" They say, "Yeah, that's you." They say, "But you've been seeing this picture for the last 10 or 20 years. What's the problem with you, man? The cops got angry. What's the problem, man?" He said, "No, no, no, calm down. I can assure you of one thing. Something was on me. And I woke up during this midnight and discover that it wasn't me the past 20 years. Something just left me. Something came out of me and left. I have been in a marriage that I didn't know what was going on here. What's going on?" And he said, "I suspect that something was done for me to marry this woman. Because this is the first time that I really see this woman who she is. I didn't know about all this." See, that's the same thing that happened with people who are lunatics, people who are possessed with major demons in their lives. They don't even know that they are lunatics. They don't even know that they are naked and walking on the street. They don't know what they are saying. They are not in charge of their mind. Why? Somebody else is in charge of it. If you show them a picture of them after they've been cured, healed, or delivered, they are shocked. It's like it's never happened. They are like, "How did you allow this to happen to me? I was running through the street nude, and you allowed this to happen to me?" He said, "We thought you knew." He said, "No, I have no idea." People of God, I've been with people who didn't even know that they were lunatics, that they were in the neuropsychiatric ward.
for some years. They have no ideas that they were there. By the time they recover, they say, why do I have all this medicine in my cabinet? They said, that's the medicine that we're giving to you in the hospital. They said, when was I in the hospital? Say, yeah, you were all these many years. Say, wow. And that's what happened. When this thing wear off, problem gonna brew up. My prayer for you is, if you were married or trapped into any relationship, business, job, marriage, I pray that it be destroyed so that you can know what you are doing. God, let me give you another example you need to know. A lot of men who marry trophy wives, they are always, many a times, older than the woman.
The what?
They are many a times older. By age than the woman. They always go after innocent women.
Yeah.
And many women who get married to, who uses witchcraft to marry certain men, are always street smarter than those men, no matter the age of those men.
Yeah.
So every woman is not going to be as naive as Chantel or know it. The person who uses witchcraft is always street smarter. They always know. They have a motive for coming into the relationship. But Esther wasn't like that. We will continue tomorrow. We will continue tomorrow to look at the reason for a feast. Why you need a feast. So that when you're invited to a feast, you know, especially feast by royalties, you know what you're getting into. People of God, remember to support our ministry by going to www.idikaimeriministry.com. Remember to support us. Write to us at P.O. Box 2491, Wichita, Kansas State 67201. Email us, idikaimeri@idikaimeriministry.com. Or you can email me personally if you have something serious that you want me to deal with. idikaimeri2000@gmail.com. God Almighty bless you. I want you to begin to go through the internet and look at the series Chosen for Honor and begin to look at this. Let's go back to what Berlin said. You must know what you are doing. You must know what you are entering into. A person of honor, first and foremost, must know what they are going into. A person of honor must sit down and study what they are entering into. No matter how young, no matter how old, sit back and know exactly. Ask questions and ask God to reveal secrets that are hidden from you so that you don't fall into traps. So that you know that you are entering into this with a clear conscience, that you love somebody and you are coming to help somebody fulfill their dreams and for them to fulfill your dreams. This is not a joke. This is serious. Tomorrow we will go into Esther's feast and the feast that the king threw to celebrate the beginning of the reign of a new queen. And I'm going to show you how one person's disobedience after hundreds of years came back to haunt the Jews. Listen, let me tell you something. Remember that Esther and Mordecai came from the tribe of the Benjaminite, the tribe of Benjamin. And a man who was a king from the tribe of Benjamin, a man who was a king. His name was King Saul. God told him to go to war and wipe out everybody. Everybody. He spared some people. Those that he spared, the people that he spared came together again, and they are going to punish the Jewish people for disobedience. Many of you did not know that that is the bottom. Honor is at the bottom of the book of Esther. God said to you, do the honorable thing. Wipe away everybody, everybody in a territory. Don't let one human being live. And then you decide to go and do your own thing. When God gives you an instruction to follow and a direction to obey, and you mess it up, it will come back to haunt your descendants. It will come back to haunt your descendants. The Agagites, remember the story their mom and dad told them that the Jewish, the Hebrews did to them in ancient times. And they are going to revenge. Thank God for Esther and Mordecai. And this law is very important. You have to know it. There are certain things that you should not do, or you shouldn't start, because it will come back to haunt you. What a Benjaminite, somebody from the tribe of Benjamin, a king, did not do, the vengeance and revenge will happen in the future. See, that is the reason why God said to Abraham, Sarah is going to give you a child. Don't worry about the delay. It will come. And many of you have been disobedient because you think your prayer is not being answered quickly. If God is going to bless you, sometimes it happens in one day, sometimes it comes gradually. He does it because he wants you to enjoy it, and he wants it protected for you. And many of you think that God is slow, and you will go and do something else to try and help God. God is not looking for help from you. Abraham went and met Ishmael, and the rest is history. There are certain people that the Jewish people should have killed, all of them. Because that was the reason why God brought Abraham to the land of Canaan, was for the sons of Abraham to carry out the judgment of God. Many of you think that judgment is until when Jesus returns. That's not true. You have been chosen to carry out God's judgment on the earth, both spiritually and otherwise. If you are not ready to conquer other people are waiting to conquer you. If you are not ready to buy up land and be land owners, outsiders are going to get it, and you will be their slave. You better know what I'm telling you. America is coming to that place, and Europe. If you are not willing to push your religion, others are going to push their own above yours. I want you beginning from now, beginning from tomorrow, you will begin to pay attention. You begin to pay attention to what we are going to begin to read. Because you're going to see how lack of honor become the bedrock for revenge and vengeance. That's why I say to each and every one of you, if people did you wrong in the past, don't accept them back into your life. Many of you will not listen. If somebody dug you, somebody did you wrong so terribly, let them go. Because they've already shown you who they really are. Don't let them back, no matter what. Do not let them back. And you are going to see how the sons of the Agagites, how they came back to revenge their history. Have you not seen that whenever Muslims want to go on this blood sharing, where do they target? They target Christians and they target their ancient blood rivalry, the Jews. Have you not seen it? People of God, there is an ancient hatred on the earth. There is an ancient hatred on the earth. If unbelievers, whether they are Muslims or other religions, or people who don't have no religion, if they want to destroy people, they always begin to fight Christians and Jews. Why? Because we have the true God. Satan will always motivate them to fight two groups of people. And that is why those two groups of people should become the world rulers, should not joke with their lives. We should be the richest, so that we can keep our position here on the earth. If not, those with ancient hatred against you, they will come for their revenge, because their forefathers and mothers told them what your parents did against them, or what they did against you. And blood will continue to be spilled. Let's face it, that's what you are going to see in the book of Esther. It's not just that Esther married a king. It's more than that. So beginning from tomorrow, you are going to see the deep things, and that will help you. You go to the country where you are, when everybody comes to greet you, you bring something for people to drink, to eat, and so on. Not me. Not me. And they are there drinking and planning how to kill you. There are people that I don't want around me. There are people whom what their fathers did against my father, they did against my mother, did against me. I let them go. I forgive them, but I banish them. They can never come back to me, no matter how it is, because there's an ancient boundary between us. This is not a joke. This is not a joke. This is serious. You will see ancient hatred come into play from tomorrow. I'll see you tomorrow on behalf of our team. The Kai Mary saying to you, good night. See you tomorrow morning.
Good night, thank you.
Yeah.